The paradigm shift that you have to undergo when using radio management is to get away from this concept of having one radio, one code plug. This has served us very well in the past, but in order to move forward, we have to start thinking differently. So when working with radio management, there are two concepts that you need to think of. You need to discard this concept of having one radio, one code plug, and you need to start thinking of configurations and sets. So what are configurations and sets really? I like to picture them as Lego blocks. So you have a Lego block. It's this big. And this Lego block can be used to make a castle. It can be used to make a house. It can be used to make a motor car. It can be used to make an aeroplane. The block doesn't change, but it's used in different parts of each model to create something else. And so this is how radio management works. We have blocks which are, let's say, configurations, and blocks which are sets. And these configurations and sets can be used in different scenarios to create a configuration for the radio. And the way that I try to draw it is something like this. So the green blobs, these are the sets, and these are linked to configuration. So what is in a set? Set is essentially all the settings that you would find in a radio. So, for example, the buttons on the radio. That is defined by one set. So what button which does that does each function? This is defined in the set. A set can be used by multiple configurations. So you could have a contact list, for example, from one radio being used by another three radios, for example, or all of the radios, or only one radio. It's up to you. So configuration basically defines what is going to go potentially into any radio. And a configuration can be shared between multiple radios. So you could have a configuration shared between all the radios used in a specific department. Or you could have a configuration shared by all radios which perform a certain function, for example, like a manager. There is one other piece of information, but it's not something that you would really configure. It's just used. This is called an MVO. MVO stands for Mobile Version Options. And this basically tells radio management what type of radio this is and what features are enabled in this radio. So there's nothing really to configure in the MVO, but you have to reference it when you are setting up the radio in radio management. We'll get to see that soon. So each radio could have a configuration that consists of multiple sets, and those sets could be shared between multiple configurations, and each configuration could be used by multiple radios. Looking at the elements of radio management, there are different components. Don't try to, let's say, overthink this. Just think of it as a single suite, a single set of applications. But essentially, we have a number of components, things that we will talk about or refer to. The first one of these is, of course, radio management itself. This basically is the database that contains all the information about radios, about everything. All the configurations, sets, MVOs, licenses, firmware, all of this is stored inside this radio management database. So if you've ever worked with SQL or Access databases, just think of it as a database where all the information is stored. Now, there are different applications which access this database. The first one of these is the job processor. So if you read a radio, or if you program a radio or write a radio using radio management, the job processor is the thing that would take all the configurations, all the MVOs, and put this together to send to the radio. It doesn't program the radio. It just compiles all this information from the database. The job processor sends this information onto the device programmer. The device programmer is the thing that will send the information to the radio through the different means. So we know that we can program the radios on certain models over the air using OTAP. We can program the radios using Wi-Fi. So if the radio has Wi-Fi enabled or available in it, you can program the radio through Wi-Fi. And we can program the radio through a programming cable, through a standard USB, the normal USB programming cable. Or we can program the radio over the air. All of these programming methods are supported or processed by the device programmer. Now, all of this is controlled. Well, not really all of this is controlled, but when you want to change anything inside the radio management database, you would access it using this client application. The client application connects to the radio management server, the database, and you can access all the information stored in the database that way. You make any changes, that gets saved back in the database. If you want to send any information to the radio, like writing the radio or reading the radio, you would do this from radio management client, and this would instruct the device programmer or the job processor to do something. Now, I said that the device programmer connects to the radios, and it will do this in different ways. One of the possibilities is to do over the air, and if we're going to be sending code plug updates or configuration updates to the radio over the air, we would use a feature in the radio or in the repeaters called NAI, Network Application Interface. This works together with a piece of software which we call MNIS, Motorola Network Interface Service. Don't try and remember that. It's basically a service that runs on the computer somewhere, and it acts like a kind of a router. It routes data between the IP cloud, so everything that is happening on the device programmer or on the computer network, and the radio network. So from the radio side, MNIST appears to be a radio, and from the IP cloud side, from the computer network side, MNIST appears to be like a computer or an endpoint of the network. And basically they connect, MNIST connects the radio cloud to the IP cloud. So they can essentially talk to each other in terms of data. Now, if you're going to be using over the air programming, so sending the radio updates over the air, one of the applications that you will probably need, well, you should use, you must use, is DDMS. So DDMS stands for Device Discovery and Mobility Service. It's essentially an application or a service that runs on the PC, and it tells, in this case, for example, device programmer, whether a radio is turned on or off, and which time slot or site this radio is on. So that when the radio or when radio management or device programmer wants to send data to the radio over the air programming, it knows where to send this data, which direction it should go. If you're not going to be using MNIST, the other possibility is to use a piece of hardware called a control station. What is a control station? A control station is essentially a motor turbo radio connected to the PC, and this radio is acting like a kind of a modem. Any data coming from the IP network gets sent to the radio, and the radio sends this out over the air. Okay. If you're going to be using a control station, then you would plug the radio into the PC or into the server, if you want to call it that, using a USB, using the programming cable for that radio. And the driver that the PC uses to connect to the radio is called the RNDIS driver. It's a driver which originates from Microsoft, and it essentially tells the computer that a MOTOTRBO radio is a network connection. All of the applications that I've spoken about here, DDMS, MNIST, device programmer, job processor, radio management server, all of these can go onto a single computer, so a single server running all of these applications at the same time. Or if you have a very large network or a, disparate network, you can install all of these applications on different servers. So you could have a server in one location, which is handling the radio management server, the SQL bits. You can also have the job processor on the server, or you can run these things, all of these things, in different virtual machines. So if you are into this machine virtualization, running VMware or whatever, you can put all of these elements into separate virtual machines, thereby creating quite a powerful server. The only exception, if you're going to be using virtualization, is if you're going to be using the RNDIS driver and programming radios through a USB programming cable. This has some issues. It may work or it may not work. So the recommendation is, if you're going to be using either a control station or programming radios through a standard USB cable, plugging in, plugging out, then it's better to put the device programmer on a separate non-virtualized machine, so a standard PC or whatever. It's something you would do in any case, because not everyone is going to be sitting in front of a server with their programming cables. So let's have a look at some possible configurations. So here we have a typical setup using a control station. So you have your radio management database, your server, your job processor, and the connection between the two can either be on the same computer or it can be through IP. Then the job processor creates the jobs, and this gets sent to the device programmer, and the device programmer will send this to the control station, and it does so using this RNDIS driver. It's just the standard MOTOTRBO radio driver. At the same time, information about the radio's status. So when a radio is turned on and you're going to be using a control station, one of the features that you're going to use in the radio is ARS. ARS basically is a piece of information that the radio will send when it turns on. So as the radio turns on, sends ARS to the control station. The control station will send this piece of data to DDMS, and DDMS will tell device programmer radio XYZ is on or it's off. So basically, DDMS prevents a device programmer trying to program a radio or poll a radio that is not there. It doesn't have to waste its time. If you try to send a job to a radio that is turned off, the device programmer will check with DDMS. DDMS will say, yes, this radio is on, or no, this radio is turned off. And the device programmer doesn't have to waste its time trying to check if that radio is there. Because if we don't use ARS and we don't use DDMS, what will happen is that if job processor sends a job to the device programmer will try to send this to the radio, and it will send some query packets. It will poll the radio. So this occupies some airtime. And of course, if you're going to be sending a lot of jobs, it's going to impact on the capacity, the core capacity of your radio network. So it's always a good idea to use DDMS, and DDMS of course only works if you're going to be using ARS. So you need to enable ARS in the radios and you need to install DDMS. There are some exceptions, but we'll come to those. The other possibility is to use MNIS and NAI. So it's pretty much the same setup as before. You have your radio management server. Obviously, you connect into the radio management server using your client. So this would be your laptop or whatever. The radio management database is connected to the job processor. And the job processor connects into the device programmer, which sends the jobs out. In this case, however, we are using MNIS. So MNIS gets installed on the PC where the device programmer is. And this communicates with the radio network. And I've just drawn a repeater here, but it could be an IP site connect work. It could be a capacity plus network. It doesn't really matter. The connection between MNIS and the radio world is via a repeater or several repeaters. Again, you would use ARS in the radio. So when the radio turns on, it sends an ARS message to the control station. In this case, it would send it to MNIS. Okay, so because there's no control station here, MNIS is like a radio on the radio network side. So it actually has a radio ID. So you would set up MNIS with a particular radio ID, and you would set up ARS in the radios to send their ARS message to MNIS, to this ID used by MNIS. MNIS sends the presence information to DDMS, and DDMS will inform device programmer if it wants to send a job, is this radio there or not. The third possibility here is to only do configuration over Wi-Fi. The setup is fairly simple. You have your database, you have job processor, you have your device programmer, but you're not using DDMS and you're not using MNIS. The reason being is that the connection between the Wi-Fi access point here and the device programmer is purely IP. The radio does not use ARS on Wi-Fi. Instead, it uses a feature which is used by many different applications, which is called a DNS service discovery. So when the radio switches on, it connects to the Wi-Fi access point. Okay, it obviously has to be within range of the Wi-Fi access point. And when it connects into the Wi-Fi access point, it's going to be sending out this DNS SD message. This is received by the device programmer. And if there are any jobs for this radio, OTAP jobs, or firmware updates, or whatever, this then gets sent to the radio over Wi-Fi. You can, of course, use a combination of all three, and you can put all of these applications in different locations. So here is a typical example. You may have seen this diagram already. So we have our radio management server, our database, and a central location. It's sitting somewhere. Okay. We connect into this server through our normal clients. This can be your laptop. And we have, in this case, three locations. These could be three separate customers, for example. So customer A, customer B, customer C. And the site at customer A is using MNIS. So you would have a PC sitting there, maybe a small PC running a device programmer, MNIS and DDMS. And this connects into the radio network. So all of the jobs, all of that is set up on your side. It gets sent through the network. Here I'm showing a VPN. VPN makes it a little bit, I would say, easier in terms of networking because everything is sitting on the same network. But not only that, it also solves a lot of problems with security. So the connection between the device programmer and the job processor is through IP. So don't worry too much about the fact of the VPN here. That's a networking thing. The main thing is that there is an IP connection between the device programmer and the job processor. If we look at customer B here, they're not using any radios which support OTAP or Wi-Fi. They have maybe old radios or radios like the DP1400, which don't do any of these things. They can only be programmed through a programming cable. Just because a radio does not support OTAP or does not support Wi-Fi, it does not mean that it cannot be used or cannot be set up in radio management. You can set up a radio in radio management that is old, so the first generation of MOTOTRBO radios. You can set up a radio in radio management that is a very simple radio, so the DP1400, SL1600. All of these radios can be configured in radio management and programmed remotely by the using this device programmer. So here you have at customer B, there could be a simple laptop or a very small PC which has the programming cable connected to it. So all the user has to do, and you don't even have to go out to site, you just go and you tell the customer, okay, I'm going to be reconfiguring your radios. Just bring them in one by one, plug them on the PC, and let radio management do its thing. So all they have to do is come in, plug it in, sit there, wait 1 or 2 minutes, whatever, however long it takes for a firmware update, or a few seconds for a configuration update, and it gets done. All they have to do is sit there, wait for the radio to restart, then they plug the next radio in, and they carry on like that. If we look at customer C here, they're just using Wi-Fi. So in this case here, they would have like maybe a central location where they would bring radios in. As soon as the radio comes into range of the Wi-Fi and is turned on, it will get its configuration update. So this is very useful if, for example, you have to do firmware updates to large fleets of radios. You don't need to travel to site. All you need to have is a simple PC connected to a Wi-Fi access point. And when the radios connect to this Wi-Fi access point, they will receive their configuration updates. So a really good means of configuring large number of radios at different locations. And the beauty here is that you don't need to travel to site. None of these locations here require you to get out of the office, although it would be nice to do that sometimes, but none of these jobs here require you to travel to site, you know, because to go sit there for days on end waiting for radios to come in to be programmed is a complete waste of your time. And so with radio management, you can save yourself a lot of time so that you can focus on, let's say, more important work or work that, let's say, requires you to do a little bit of thinking and not sitting there and plugging in programming cables.